for tornadoes and thunderstorms and that sort of thing here in the Midwest. But have either one of you ever lived on the coast where you had to worry about hurricanes?
Summer?
Okay.
It was in Shreveport, Louisiana. We didn't get hit by any, but rain
potential
was
there.
Potential rain meant something completely different down there than it does up here.
Raining cats and dogs, that sort of thing?
Like, yeah. Yeah, and fish. Depending on how strong the updraft is.
No way!
I've heard stories where, I've never lived it, but I've heard stories of sometimes it will gather up like small fish and rain them down.
Dang. My mother-in-law, she's passed away now, but lives in Mississippi, and she said that that's how they got fish in their pond was from it raining fish.
Yeah.
That's crazy.
So we always thought that wasn't the way. But maybe it was true.
No, we, I remember once we had to pull over during a major thunderstorm. It just got off the Gulf of Mexico, and you couldn't see outside the window. I mean, like, literally, there's nothing on the window. You couldn't see the
windshield. We shouldn't be driving then.
We didn't know it was coming. It was dry, and there's a cloud, and then all of a sudden it hit, and there was... It wasn't like we were the only ones on the road. The entire traffic pulled over on the middle of a highway.
Was it short-lived, though, or did it last
long time? Yeah, it only lasted like 10, 20 minutes, but still, first time seeing that type of torrential rain, I was like, that's different than Midwestern torrential rain.
Mm-hmm. So we'll be seeing a few hurricanes. So actually this is, this isn't even a hurricane. This is a typhoon. And, you know, they call tropical cyclones different things, different parts of the world. So this is a famous typhoon. It's a super typhoon, November 2013. So the generic term is tropical cyclone. So actually, our hurricanes are really tropical cyclones. And we're going to talk about stages of hurricanes. So a hurricane is a mature stage. And it needs to have a minimum wind speed, and that's 74 miles per hour. But again, we clock that while it's building and that sort of thing, instead of after the fact. All right. So, of course, if a tropical cyclone occurs in our neck of the woods, our part of the world, we call them hurricanes. If it gets that 74 miles per hour. And we're going to talk about different ocean basins. So let me grab the globe. So here's North America. And we kind of have, we have source regions for hurricanes. We're probably most notably this hurricane over here in the North Atlantic. But we can have hurricanes come and get them over here. Now, one of the cool things I think about hurricanes is naming them. It's kind of fun, right? We'll go see if your name's on the list of names. But each ocean basin has their own list of names. So that makes sense. So if you are in the Western Pacific, so here's the Pacific. Okay, so the Western Pacific. So if you're over here, you're going to call tropical cyclones typhoons. Is that the Western Pacific? Yes. And if you are in the Indian Ocean near Australia, road trip, it's on my bucket list. Okay, so here's Australia, Indian Ocean. Oh, Indian Ocean, okay. They are just called cyclones. Okay, so tropical cyclones are cyclones. So, usually cyclones, if you're looking at ocean basin, usually they will mature in the western edge of an ocean basin. So western edge of an ocean basin. Right, where's North America? Okay, the North Atlantic Ocean Basin, western edge. So that works. This is a aftermath of Hurricane Sandy, Superstorm Sandy. And the other thing about names, there's a lot of things about names. We'll talk about kind of a list of things, do's and don'ts about naming your hurricane. But if it's a really bad hurricane, the name gets retired. So otherwise, they kind of have these six repeating lists that they visit each year. So Hurricane Sandy, I'm pretty sure Sandy's been retired. Craziness. So this is, let's see, kind of showing you the name things. So we said hurricanes are us. We have the North Atlantic and the North Pacific. And then we said that typhoons are over there, kind of the Western Pacific. And then we said cyclones were down here near Australia. Okay, so those are cyclones. So you might recognize some of these names. Each color is a different hurricane. So one of the things you might already recognize is, does it look like they kind of have this sort of, they all kind of have this sort of curving thing. And they're curving around something that looks invisible, but I'll put the letter H here. Of course, H stands for high, and we've been talking about these semi-permanent highs in our ocean basins. And in the northern hemisphere, air goes, and so currents go clockwise. So actually, they are just kind of tripping on that semi-permanent high that's there. So of course, you see Katrina. The other thing about, like, if you pick Katrina, for instance, and you guys know this drama, if you watch it on TV, I think Katrina's this guy right here. Okay. The way you read this map is, can you kind of see the dot, dot, dots right here? Okay, that means it's not quite mature to be a hurricane yet. It's what we call a tropical storm. Okay, and once it's a solid line, then it's a full-fledged hurricane. But isn't it interesting how it kind of, they kind of curve and they wiggle? Look at this guy. You're like, really? Okay, I just think that's interesting. The other thing that's kind of interesting is, check this out. Do hurricanes ever go on land? Yeah, kind of. The biggest thing they bring, they're dot, dot, dots, they're tropical storms then. The biggest thing they bring is lots, buckets full of ocean water. But it's not salty by then. I wonder how that works. Okay. So the anatomy of a hurricane kind of looks like this. And you've heard of the eye of a hurricane, right? Okay. Kind of around, the eye is the center, and around the eye are kind of a group of thunderstorms. So we, on the video we just watched, it said, are tornadoes, is it calm? You know, are tornadoes calm in the center of their vortex? Well, actually, hurricanes are calm in the center of their eyes. And then around the eye, these little circles here are a thunderstorm, kind of looking down at it. These are be like the tops. These are cells. So these are thunderstorm cells around the eye. That's the eye wall. And then the spiral rain bands, they kind of come out like a, you know, you've seen pictures of them, but, and it kind of looks like a spiral galaxy. And then these actually have thunderstorms too. So it does look like a galaxy. So there's kind of a good figure of a thunderstorm. Okay. Now the eye is a busy place. Let's take a look at the eye. Now down at the bottom of the eye, I'm going to put a letter L. At the surface of the eye, there's a low pressure. I'm going to try to convince you of this. Actually, over the top of the eye is a high pressure. So you kind of have this low here and this high here. Okay. And what do we know about, if you have that difference, basically vertical difference, you're going to have what you see here, this descending air. So you see this descending air. And if you can get air to go down, remember that it's going to squeeze together and warm up. So it's going to adiabatically warm. And so actually, not only is it calm in the center of your eye, but it's nice, warm, and toasty. The movie The Day After Tomorrow is kind of supposed to be like a hurricane on steroids. And so, yeah, when the eye goes over them, he knows there's more to come. Let's see, what else do we have? So it's actually being fed. I like this figure because you can kind of see we talked about inflow. It's kind of like that, inflow. And we kind of have outflow up here at the top. So we have outflow here and inflow here. And the same thing that fuels our thunderstorms, warm, moist air, basically condensing, is the same thing, the condensation is the same thing that fuels your hurricanes. So over here in this little figure are two lines. The yellow line is pressure. So basically, I told you there's a low here, so these would be surface pressures. So this low right there is the center of the eye. So the lowest is in the center of the eye. When we evaluate what category a hurricane is, one of the criteria is to see how low that low is. And the lower it is, that means the crazier change you have in pressures, that means the crazier wind you have in the crazier wind you have. So related to pressures, then we have wind speed. So you can actually see the wind speed here is pretty fast, but it ramps up like right at the eye. And notice that the wind drops off kind of the middle of the eye. So that's creepy. I'm just saying. Okay, so we have outflow kind of at the top. And so if you think about it, it's kind of weird, those cool satellite images, like we saw that one of the super typhoon, those cool satellite images, I think you're seeing, I don't know if you're seeing outflow or inflow or kind of both. So this is kind of the, and this isn't new to us in this class because we definitely talked about air moving vertically. If we have convergence aloft, it will move down and it can actually sustain a high, that sort of thing. So we have air moving vertically here too. But it's kind of like the slide said, the top, the thing that contains your hurricanes is the same thing that kind of contains your unstable thunderstorm cells. It's the tropopause. You'll definitely see overshooting tops, though, in a hurricane, the thunderstorms of a hurricane, just like you'd see them in normal thunderstorms. So this is actually Hurricane Katrina. This is looking at the, you are in the eye, looking kind of outside. That is creepy. So here's your eye, the wall, and you are, this is the eye. So here in this chapter, your textbook talks about these airplanes. They're called reconnaissance airplanes. Yep. Maybe the day after tomorrow they send out reconnaissance airplanes, I think. Didn't go well for them. but they're equipped with, you know, to know what they're doing. So the eye wall, excuse me, not the eye wall, but the eye itself travels, let's see. If its diameter, we could do the math. If it's about 20 miles, if the eye is about 20 miles wide, then it takes about an hour and a half for the eye to pass you. So basically before the eye you have crazy wind. Okay, during the eye shouldn't be so bad. And then after the eye you're going to get hit again. So these are surface maps. This is actually Hurricane Fran. So these surface maps, these are isobars. These are, the tighter the isobars are, of course, the crazier the wind. We've been talking about that. So to me, you have very tight isobars there. You should expect lots of wind. And actually, those isobars are kind of huddling, centering on the eye of Hurricane Fran. So this is September 5th, and this is September 6th. So instead of recurving, what we call that recurving around the North Atlantic Ocean Basin, Hurricane Fran comes on land. And so what happened to the wind? It slowed down, exactly. And like you would imagine, it kind of, once it leaves the ocean like that, it can take its water inland, but it's kind of the beginning of the end for it. Yeah. So we'll talk about this idea. You've probably heard of the term downgrading, like your storm got downgraded. Okay. So actually, this one got downgraded from the full-fledged hurricane that has to at least have winds of 74 miles per hour to the step below it, which is called a tropical storm. All right. So recipe for a hurricane. These are the three things you need for a hurricane. There might be some kind of subtle things there too, but so you need to have nice warm water. And that's why the whole warm water thing is why scientists are really looking at this global warming thing seriously and wondering what kind of effect it could have on activity like hurricanes. But I've heard a scientist say, just be careful. Don't go trying to link global warming up with a bunch of stuff that it does not link up with. So you need nice warm water. You need a sufficient twisting. And when we talked about the Coriolis force, which is caused from the Earth spinning on its axis, we said that at the poles it's greatest and at the equator it's zero. So I think I already mentioned that you have to kind of scoot at least 5 degrees north or 5 degrees south of the equator in order to get the spin to create your hurricane. And then you need to have your thunderstorms. There's thunderstorm clouds. That's the heart of your hurricane. And so in order to have thunderstorm clouds, you need to have unstable air. Okay. So I'm going to talk you through the steps of forming a hurricane. And for us here, this one right here, North Atlantic Ocean Basin. And actually what meteorologists do is they kind of focus on this part of the world. And we talked about the Hadley cell, the Farrell cell, and the polar cell, okay? I was thinking about that. I'm like, I'm glad we talked about that. So remember we said that we have a prevailing easterly trade winds here. So honestly, that's how and they're called easterly waves. They're catching the Hadley cell this way. So we need some sort of uplift. So what works great is if we have a little kind of kink, if we have I think the slide says a little bit of meridional flow. Okay, meridional flow would be kind of talking about those Rossby waves at upper elevation. So if you can get that going on, you can have a place for basically your clouds to develop, your thunderstorms to develop clear over there. Off the edge of South America, or off the edge of Africa. So they kind of come in bunches. We call a cluster easterly waves, which I don't even know if easterly waves is necessarily a step, but could be. But aside from the whole easterly waves things, the whole building up to a hurricane or tropical cyclone, remembers the generic name, it starts as a tropical disturbance. So a tropical disturbance, the winds are got to be less than 39 miles per hour. They're just kind of these cluster of thunderstorms headed that way for our East Atlantic hurricanes. So if it has at least winds, now that's not very high, at least winds of 30 miles per hour, and the low is sufficiently low, it can be upgraded from a disturbance to a depression, tropical depression. You've probably heard that term before, tropical depression. And then after a tropical depression, then it comes a tropical storm. The exciting thing about a tropical storm, this stage of a tropical cyclone, so it's not 74 miles per hour yet, but it gets named. I think that's so exciting. So it gets a name. It gets to keep the name whether it goes ahead and matures into a tropical cyclone or not. And then when that central low intensifies, and it's kind of related to basically that warm, moist air kind of feeding those thunderstorms, it's a beast. Then it gets elevated in name and status to a hurricane. Now, remember, we call them hurricanes. The generic name is tropical cyclone. Very good. And that's it. Now, remember, it can get downgraded. So actually, when it goes over land, like we saw Hurricane Fran, it will go back down. So it was a tropical cyclone or a hurricane. It went to tropical storm, tropical depression, tropical disturbance. So again, this is what we call a hurricane. Cool. So I think a few slides ago it said something about 1 in 10. Is it 1 in 10 disturbances becomes a storm? Okay, and this is actually how many tropical storms, which is the big line, actually mature to get the wind sufficient to be called a tropical cyclone or a hurricane. So, and this is just focusing on, again, this ocean basin right here. Looks like it peaks in September. All right. So the whole kind of unraveling of the hurricane, so it loses its energy if any of these three things happen. If it goes over water that's colder, and actually, as we talked, this is called a recurving. I think that's neat, this whole recurving, this kind of around this high, this going clockwise. As it goes towards the poles, that is colder water. As it moves on land, it will kind of start to dissipate. And if there's something happening at upper elevations that kind of screws up your hurricane, then it will dissipate too. Okay. So the upper level winds kind of do a good job of kind of steering these large weather systems. They catch a ride within the Hadley cell on the easterly trade winds that we've talked about before. But like we see around that semi-permanent high in the Atlantic Ocean, North Atlantic Ocean, it's going to move clockwise and move towards the poles. And as it gets up against colder water, it will be downgraded. So these ocean basins have big old H's. Where we go? You have an H here, an H there. This is called the Bermuda High, and I can't remember what this is called. It's got kind of that name. So again, kind of linking something from Unit 3 into Unit 4, we talked about the polar jet stream, which actually kind of gives us kind of the meandering in the upper elevations. We saw that the peak activity for the North Atlantic Ocean Basin is in September, and actually that coincides with the polar jet strengthening. So these are some more hurricanes. We have, these are all in 2004. Notice that, what do they call that in Florida? It's not, is it the Key? What is this thing? Peninsula. Florida Peninsula. Okay. So isn't it weird how that you have them kind of crisscrossing? It's just kind of, it's almost like they have a mind of their own sometimes. And I think we looked at this one before, but I'm going to go ahead and take us out to this website. I didn't print these front and back. What is this? Goodness gracious. This website, I think it's kind of neat. I got it from your textbook. I didn't make it a hot link yet. So it's very busy app, very, I call it an app, but very busy program. So what you can do is you can choose, for instance, an ocean basin. We can choose the, let's see, East Atlantic. That'd be us. And you can choose, I did this in my office and it like went just like terrible. I mean, a lot of them. So I'll choose, those are pressures. Let's just choose a year. if you're into such things, you might check it out. And of course, it's like you can zoom in using the mouse. So what's this guy? So over there, oh, that's Hurricane Charlie. And you kind of get the idea. I'm sure it can do a lot of things. So, anyway. So I'll push that out there on Twitter in case you're wanting it. Okay, so here are kind of the, oh, look at the skies, the kind of the, that must be clear in the west, and those were clouds that were, and so this, I just think it looks weird because you have the sun and the dark clouds, and, yeah. Okay, so rules for naming your tropical, now notice it's not tropical cyclone for naming your tropical storm, because that's when they get their name. So each ocean basin has its own set of names, and we'll kind of take a look at those in a minute. So for us here in North America, our kind of source regions for hurricanes, of course most hurricanes are here, but we can kind of get some kicking around over here. I think these kind of begin at the Gulf and come over, I think. And they used to be all female names, but now they alternate male-female, which is much better. They're alphabetical. But some letters of the alphabet are hard to come up with a name, so those are pulled. So, for instance, we don't worry about Q's and U's and X's and Y's and Z's. They're not on a list. Well, if you subtract those, there are 26 letters of the alphabet. You take out those five letters, then you'll have 21 letters. And there have been seasons like Katrina, the season where, was that 06, I think?
I think so.
Was it? Five, seems like I read it recently.
I think so.
Was it 05? Okay. 05?
It was earlier.
Yep, it was 05. Very good. On the next slide. In 05, or the previous slide. So in that year, we ran out of, I think it might have been Wilma. I mean, like we went to the end of the alphabet. So like this says, if you run out of letters of the alphabet, because there's just like more than 21 named tropical storms, then you have to go to the Greek alphabet. It's kind of weird. Let's see. Oh, and then your textbook, actually, I'm going to show you the figure from your textbook that shows the six columns. So basically, if you call those columns A, B, C, D, E, F. Okay, so once you get to F, then you go back to column A, B, C, D. Okay, so they're recycled. But I said that you can retire the really bad ones. Okay, so basically, and I think it's interesting, and you might too, like if you just Google retired hurricane names, and then of course you kind of stumble on the whole, oh yuck, you know, because they're retired because they were bad. Some of the hurricanes, tropical cyclones we're going to look at actually don't have this naming convention because they were before this naming convention was put in place. Okay, so here you go. Here's a figure from your textbook. 2014, 15, 16. So, do you guys see your names?
Version.
A version of it?
Felipe.
Yeah,
Felipe.
There you go.
Kind of there then.
And that's next year.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. No Jacob?
No.
Okay, so what you need to hope is that all the J's, that there are some bad ones here, and they'll get kicked out, and then you have maybe have a chance to get to replace them. Let's see. I thought I had. It's coming. So, let's take a look just kind of briefly at the other ocean basins. So you see the title of this. It actually says this is Gulf of Mexico too. This is for the North Atlantic, Gulf of Mexico, Caribbean Sea. They all share the same list. But the North Pacific has a different list. Okay, so let's see if they agree. So do you see Felipe? Yep, there we go. Okay, so this is the same list as your textbook, right?
Yeah.
So how about the Eastern North Pacific? No. And then they get a little more exotic if you go to, see, the Central North Pacific, and they're not, how do I say this, they're just kind of different lists. Those are kind of out of our realm. But they still have names.
Looks like Hawaiian or something.
Yeah. Central North Pacific.
So yeah, that does look kind of could be. Hawaiian Islands. So interesting. They don't even say, like for ours, not that we're all that, but we actually say 2017, there you go. And for theirs, I don't know what list they're on. Let's see. I'm tired. Parking names. So these are the ones that are retired. Yep, Sandy's retired. Look like they're going back. Irene, 11. Ike, 08. 05, see, we had, Katrina, yeah. Rita, Stan, Wilma.
Wow.
Yep. And each one of these you can click on, and they kind of tell you a little bit about it. So, like what category it became. See, if I'm just looking at colors, it looks like it got this kind of purple color, category 4. So it's neat. I'll tell it myself, this has been a few years ago. I was getting ready for lecture, and I wanted to go to the internet and find out a little bit more about hurricanes. And so I found myself on Wikipedia, and it was like the current year, and it said, our current season. So I was like, well, that's interesting. And Wikipedia is terrible because they had like this bogus, I was like, dude, that like hasn't even happened. So it was like just this whole bogus statement about a hurricane that never happened. So, yes, there you go. But, yeah, sometimes. So, tornadoes use the Saffir-Simpson scale. Wait, no, they don't. Tornadoes use the enhanced Fujita scale. The EF scale, tornadoes do. Okay. Hurricanes use the Saffir-Simpson scale. They're both 5, okay, 1 through 5, and 5 is the strongest. So they have that in common. But like I said, tornadoes you do after the fact, and hurricanes you do as they're going. So the good thing about hurricanes is actually you can categorize them. If you can get a fix on how low their central low is, you know what their category is. If you can get a fix on their winds, you know their category. If you can measure their storm surge as they hit land, we'll talk about what storm surge is, you can categorize them. So kind of like, yeah, no, even to a more extent. You know how we said EF5s are pretty rare? Category 5 storms are very, very, very rare. Category 5 hurricanes. And sometimes I have to chase this down because, excuse me, I'm like, really? So Category 5 storms, there have only been 3 Cat 5 hurricanes. Cat 4 hurricanes, only 16 of those. So, I mean, that's pretty rare. So, but as you pick out a category and kind of go across, looking at the central low, the wind speed, and the storm surge, they all kind of do pretty good with agreeing to give it the same category. So, if you're supposed to keep tabs on the hurricane as it's living, okay, how do we do that? Well, we have some direct means and we have some indirect means of understanding what a hurricane's doing. So these are direct means where those aircraft actually go over critical places and they drop these things. It's the opposite of a weather balloon. You know, weather balloon goes up, these things go down. They're called drop wind sounds. And they remember we said we used the term for weather balloons, raw wind sounds, I think, for basically if the weather balloon's going to take up a gizmo, that will give you wind speed and direction. So that all makes sense. I don't think these are recoverable. I think, you know, with the weather balloons, they try to recover their little boxes after the weather balloon busts and the box comes back down with the parachute. I don't think they can recover these. I've had students before say, well, how much are they? Maybe they should try to recover them. Okay. So we'll kind of talk through when a hurricane goes over an area, what sort of damage, where does the damage come from? And it's kind of broke out into kind of categories. So the damage can come from the wind. A little bit about the wind. This figure right here, my little caption says, notice that if this storm, kind of see this nice, you see the nice eye? Actually, that's one of the things that meteorologists are looking for. If the eye is kind of fuzzy, not well defined, that means that your hurricane is not very mature and a little bit disorganized. If it's you see a nice crisp eye, that's like it's pretty organized. So if it's going this way, notice that actually the wind in this direction gets this because it's going that way, but it also has a forward motion because the whole system's moving. So they're additive. So in other words, if the wind is 175 and it's moving at 50 kilometers per hour, 175 plus 50 is 225. Okay. Now the opposite is true on the other side. In this case, we have rotation kind of fighting against the forward movement. So if it's 125 whipping around, but it's going 50 like that, then you subtract them, and don't you? No. Sorry. If it's 175 coming here and it's 50 going there, you subtract 50 from 175 and you get 125. So basically your wind on kind of the other side is less than your wind on the, would be the right side, right? So I think that's pretty cool. Okay, so this is, there it goes, it's Hurricane Igor, okay, so Hurricane Igor in 2010, this is the path Hurricane Igor took. I like these figures because notice that the red is the hurricane, but before it's red, it's yellow, so right here it's a tropical storm. And then before it's yellow, it is a tropical depression. Tropical depression. So anyway, this one is emphasizing the heavy rains part of a hurricane. And I think I mentioned if you get a hurricane going inland, that is actually what the biggest impact is, just a bunch of rain. But notice that this heavy rain actually results in most of the people that die flooding. Yep. So when we're watching that video, I kind of cringed because he seemed to go and take his vehicle in places where he probably shouldn't have been taking his vehicle. You know, you don't know what's underneath there. So, yeah. Well, how else are hurricanes destructive? Well, they can bring tornadoes. And if, on the diagram a little bit ago, if I said basically we have thunderstorm cells embedded in the eye wall, And also in the spiral arms, well, thunderstorm cells can spawn tornadoes. So this is actually just for 1 year, 2004. Throughout the year, these were the number of storm systems that came through. Some of them were just tropical storms, but some of them, I guess the other ones, were elevated to hurricanes. And these are how many tornadoes there were embedded in them. So, I mean, that's not good. Not good at all. Another problem with a hurricane is something called storm surge. So I liken storm surge to, if you've ever been in the swimming pool, are they still working? Oh my gosh. Are they done for the night, maybe? I guess it's not moving. Sorry, false alarm. If you've ever been in the swimming pool and put your arms out and kind of gone around and around, if you do it just right, kind of put your hand at the interface of the air and the water, you'll actually kind of create a wall of water, and that's storm surge. So basically, it is the wind from your hurricane intersecting with just the surface of the ocean, and it creates a wall of water. That is storm surge. And so if you kind of think about that, if you are spinning this way, okay, can you see where actually on this side of my arm, that's where my wall is? Okay, and then if you guys are the land, and I'm kind of marching up to the land, can you see where this side, you guys are not going to have storm surge, but this side you are? And then coupled with that, let's see, did I do it right? I think I did. If we have a low, basically hurricanes are just one big cyclone, tropical cyclone. So if we have a low, then it's going counterclockwise. Yeah, so counterclockwise would be like that, right? So it is going like that. So that's why we say storm surge is emphasized on the right side of the storm. So anyway, storm surge, for instance, you can see just normal water and normal tides. Okay, down here, if you're it only happens when the eye hits landfall. So storm surge does not happen it's not like a half an hour thing, as far as I can tell. Although, didn't we say it takes an hour and a half for the eye to kind of get from one? So it could, storm surge could be a while. But this was in the news with Hurricane Sandy, because with Superstorm Sandy, the tide, the moon was full, and that brings us high tide. And so actually that aggravated the storm surge. And I think where it hit, like New York area and stuff, I mean, I think they don't have much of, their coasts are really not very deep. So they really kind of, that did not help. I have another picture of storm surge. Oh, yeah. So this is trying to show you what I just showed you a minute ago. If you have cyclonic movement counterclockwise, you're going to whip that water over here to the right side. Makes sense? Think so. So here's a figure from your textbook. This is Hurricane Ike in 2008, and the emphasis here is the wall of water that basically came up and creamed this Crystal Beach in Texas. One of the heartbreakers that I've heard, and I think I heard it with Hurricane Katrina, but I guess it could be any hurricane, is in the app, when you go to talk to your insurance adjuster, if this is, if it's categorized as flooding and you don't have flood insurance, okay, what I've heard, what I understand is they'll basically say, oh, so sorry, it's a natural disaster, but it's flooding and you don't have flood insurance. That's not right. Just let me get on the record to say that. That's not right. But I also did you hear this too, that after the terrible thing with Hurricane Katrina, there were like, was it State Farm or some major pulled out of the area? They no longer provide insurance to that part. Chickens. So anyway, that does not look good. Isn't that weird though? Like that one house is standing? You're like, really?
That's what I was looking at. Mm-hmm.
That's so bizarre.
It really liked that one house.
Yeah.
So I was wondering if they, like, I don't know, were building that afterwards and never picture taking it or something.
Oh, that could be.
Well.
That looks pretty recent, though.
It looks just so,
It looks so new, but why would they do that? The destruction hasn't even been cleaned up yet.
Yeah, that's true.
There's no entrance, there's no exit, there's no... There's nothing on the ground.
But it looks so new. Yeah, if you were going to do something, you'd be do something kind of more...
Looks like one of the back windows got knocked out.
Yeah, that's true. This little window right here.
Yeah, and then there's one on the side with the yellow.
But, you know, it looks like they boarded it up. You know how, like...
Yeah.
So that's bizarre. But also notice that actually it was already on stilts.
Right.
It's lifted. Still,
that's amazing.
It's also a concrete, you can see under the concrete.
Yeah.
So everything got washed out from under.
That can't be good.
No.
Because, there's no houses over here.
Yeah.
No.
Like, oh my gosh.
No.
Interesting. So this is cyclone. So let's see, cyclones are, we said, down near Australia. So this is a different part of the world. And this is, I said that there's some new, I made some new slides since 2013, this edition, 2016 of your textbook. Because, and we'll talk about global warming and the fact that the oceans, there's more water in the oceans and the ocean water is warmer. So warmer water actually occupies more volume, and of course, more water occupies more volume. So there are places where, especially like little islands, where they're basically, their island is getting less and less. Did you ever, you guys ever watch the episode of Gilligan's Island where Gilligan went out with like a stick? He was catching lobster or something, and he would actually see like his stick went down farther and farther and farther. But he was doing something wrong, and anyway, so it looked like the island was sinking, or the, you know, I don't know, poor Gilligan. But anyway, the sea levels are rising, and this actually can work against people who are on the coasts and they are dealing with storm surge or flooding. So, between 1900 and 2013. I know I skip around these because I was getting ready for today's lecture and I couldn't decide how I wanted to do it. So these are the 10 most deadly hurricanes to strike the United States coming from either side. But I think these most look like they're Atlantic side. Remember I said that if the hurricane happened a long time ago, they don't have the male-female name. So, for instance, we just had the Galveston, Texas hurricane in the year 1900. I mean, wouldn't that be creepy, like, to go from 1899 to 1900 and all heck breaks loose? Okay, so, yeah, that's a lot of deaths, and notice that actually has an asterisk. And they say 8,000, but it could be anywhere from 10 to 12,000. And your textbook has a picture of the Galveston, Texas hurricane. But look at this, 15 years later. Like, really? You know. So, you know. What's that?
The hurricane probably moved out.
With the tides.
Yeah. That was a dark joke.
Did you say they moved out with the tides?
Yes. Storm surge joke. A dark one, too. You can use it later.
I'd say.
Come back to finish the job.
Katrina makes number three. Now, if you look out on the internet, this is deadliest. Actually, before I came here and I kind of played around with showing you the internet site, but there is most costly and there's deadliest. And they don't necessarily coincide. So, yeah. Katrina and... I would imagine, you know, when they give you a number that is 1,833, you're like, really? Do you, you know what I mean?
Yeah, you know the exact number.
Yeah, I think there's some play in that number, too.
Got a guy out there.
Yeah.
It's a
long day.
So, but you know, looking at these, just looking at the names, most of them are not female, male, female, male. So that means that they're old. And so, oh, I guess that works, though. As far as being deadly, we've gotten better at, yeah, mourning people and stuff like that than we used to be. So, but hurricanes are a bad thing when it comes to taking lives because, of course, they happen on the coast. And when people go to set their civilization, one of the things that they want is transportation. So we definitely kind of line our coasts with civilizations. But that kind of works against us. So speaking of Hurricane Katrina, and this slide reminds me of what your insurance adjuster, when they come to look at your house, what they think. Well, was it flooding? Okay, or was it the wind that got you? What are you covered for? And I might be exaggerating, but this one on the left looks so sad.
Yeah.
So above storm damage, to the right, wind damage. Like picking up entire houses. Yeah, let's leave these last slides until next week, if you guys don't mind. And I got a movie. I think I'm going to hopefully start with the movie next time so we can kind of get that in. But yay!